Right, we'll still wait a couple of minutes before starting the talk. Just before that, I will just welcome everyone. So this is our last seminar series, or our last Nansgat Live of this series. And I would like to remind everyone that you can send us your suggestions for the next series, which will start in September or October. We haven't planned the detail yet. Feel free to send us suggestions. We're looking forward to hearing about works from early career scientists and like people at every stage, basically. And we will select the speakers in a couple of weeks. So feel free to drop us an email. Another point that could be important is that we will renew a few members of the team at the end of the year, so after the next seminar series. So if you are thinking about applying, feel free to drop us an email to ask for information or to declare your intent to submit. There's no emergency for that. We have plenty of time as we will start recruiting new members around Christmas time. But if you're thinking about it, feel free to send us an email. Right, so today's speaker is Anne Guyez. She has just finished and just defended her PhD, so we can congratulate her. She's working at the GET, a center depending on the University of Toulouse, and she will present today her work about luminescence and detrial luminescence. So Anne, the floor is yours.
Yes. Hello, everyone. So as Boris told you, I'm Anne Guyez. I was a PhD student in the University of Toulouse in France for the last 3 or 4 years. Until 3 days ago, I've defended my thesis. So now I'm a PhD. So one of my main focus that I will present to you today in this talk entitled How It Glows Tell How It Flows is the development of luminescence in single grain to have insight on sediment transfer in braided river. So during my PhD, I was supervised by Stéphane Bonnet, but also by Tony Rayman and Jakob Walinga, who brought me their expertise in luminescence. And I've also collaborated with Sébastien Cartier. So landscape evolved depending on tectonic and climatic forcing on long time scale, and erosion fluxes that result from this coupling are transmitted in river system as a sediment supply. When there is a perturbation of those external forcing, it induces a perturbation in the sediment supply. For example, a perturbation in the climate induces a perturbation in the sediment supply upstream. And theoretical models have shown that this perturbation can be diluted, delayed, or buffered in river system, and that we cannot always find the signal back downstream. The main reason for that is that part of the grain of sediments in general can be stored in the floodplain for very long time, so that downstream we cannot always retrieve the signal. So the way transport processes may modify the input signal during sediment transfer from source to sink is poorly known. And the reason for that is that we don't have appropriate tool to measure dilution of the signal in fluvial system. So in the recent years, several studies have suggested that luminescence could be used as a tool to investigate surface processes. And this is also what I tried to do in my PhD, which was entitled Potential of Feldspar Single Grain Luminescence Signal to Enlight Past and Present Landscape Dynamics. So today, in the first part, I will present you luminescence, what it is, and how does it work. And then I will talk to you about how I use luminescence as a new tool for quantifying sediment transport and storage in floodplain. So luminescence. So it's mainly known as a dating method called OSL for optically stimulated luminescence. It consists in exposing a sediment, a mineral, to visible light, and to this way we can date the age of the sediment. Another family of methods that was developed also is the IRSL for infrared stimulated luminescence. It's the same, but we put infrared light on the sediment to date or to analyze. So how does it work? Luminescence can be measured within quarts of feldspar grain. And the process is that when a grain is buried in a, for example, in a floodplain, it receives ionizing radiation from the surrounding material. And luminescent signal increase through time at a rate called the dose rate. Then, if the grain is exposed to sunlight, the luminescent signal is reset in a process called the bleaching. Bleaching takes a few seconds for quartz and a few minutes for feldspar. In more detail, if we look at what is happening inside the grain, is that minerals present a structural defect in their crystal lattice. And when they receive ionizing radiation, the electrons that are normally on the valence band on stable state will move to this defect. So, for example, here we have a grain that have been buried for a very long time, a bedrock grain, and it has received energy for a long time. So all electron traps are occupied. Here we reach the limit of the method and the grain is saturated. So now if we consider that this grain is entering the river system, so it has not been exposed to light yet, and through cycle of transport and deposition, at some point, it can get exposed to sunlight and all the electrons move back to stable state. So here you see the signal is reset. Then we have this well-bleached grain here that will continue its journey on the river. And it can be buried in a river deposit, for example, where here again, it receives ionizing radiation from the surrounding material. And the luminescent signal will increase through time, gradually. Electrons move up to metastable state until there is no further space and the grain reach saturation. So this way, if we measure the luminescence within a grain, we can estimate burial time and therefore luminescence can be used as a geochronometer. So a classical way in fluvial geomorphology is to use luminescence to date, for example, terrace, which are past a river deposit. So this is partly what I've done in my PhD. Here you can see that it's me trying to sample a terrace here with a rope because it's not always too easy to access a terrace deposit. So what we do is that we take a tube like this one and we insert the tube into the deposit. Why do we do that? Is that because we need that the grain are not exposed to light before we go to the lab. So we need this type of tube that we use and we collect the grain this way. Something very original I've done in my PhD is that I've measured a lot also modern sediment. So sediment from the actual floodplain of the river. So in theory, we could consider that all the grain in those deposits should have a dose close to zero, because you see it's quite a recent deposit. But you will see in the rest of my presentation that for modern deposits, we rarely see all the grain close to zero. So then we have our tube and we go to the lab. So during my PhD, I was welcome in the Netherlands Center for Luminescence Dating at Wageningen University. I work with Tony Rayman and Jacob Wallinger, although now Tony has moved to Cologne. And the specificity of this lab is that it's a dark room laboratory. So it means that we have only red light because we need that the grain are not exposed to sunlight or to light before the measurement. So in my PhD, I've used mainly one protocol of measurement, which is the one you can find in this publication from Rayman and Pal in 2012. It's called the single grain post-infrared infrared luminescence signal measurement. And we did that at 175 degrees. So the specificity of doing single grain is that we measure grain one by one. So the reader will go through all the grain one by one and measure the luminescence of each grain independently. In average, I measure 300 grains by sample. So what the instrument do is that it exposes the grain to to infrared light. So all the electrons move back to stable state. By doing that, because they go from a high level of energy to a lower one, by doing this jump, they emit some photon, and the reader is equipped with a photon counter. So we count the photon, and then we obtain the value of the energy that were inside our brain. The next step, we need to irradiate the grain at known dose rate. So here we do that. Then we expose the grain to a red laser again, and we count the photon. And we repeat this for a range of dose rates to build a dose response curve like this one. The final step is to project the natural signal we measure in the grain onto this dose response curve to know the dose that were inside our grain. The next thing we can do if we want to have the age of the grain, we divide the dose by the dose rate, which is the environmental irradiation that the grain has received while it was buried. We measure it independently for each sample using a low radioactivity reader, which measures free decay chain and take into account also the water content, the organic content, and the latitude of our sample. Therefore, we obtain the dose rate, and we divide it to have the dose by the dose rate to have the age of the grain. In some cases, when the signal is very high, we cannot project the value from the grain onto the dose response curve, or the signal is too high, is above a 2 times D0 threshold, which is a characteristic length scale of this curve. In this case, we consider that those grains are saturated grains. They have been receiving ionizing radiation for a very long time. So this is a radial plot. It is the representation of the dose of each grain measured in one sample. We can read the dose of the grain on the right here. And on the x-axis here, you see the precision of the measurement. So in some case, the signal can be very coherent in all the grains, which is typical of good bleaching condition, and all the grain will give the same signal. For example, here in the sample from Chamberlain and Wallinga in 2019, you see that all the grain give one DE value, one dose. In our case, you see that the data are much more scattered, which reveal heterogeneous bleaching conditions. So next, we classify our grain in function of their dose. So there are three categories. The first are the one with the highest signal, the saturated grain, that we classify with the criteria I just told you before. Then we have the grain with the weakest signal. So that's the one here, the white one here. They are close to the bootstrap minimum H model. So it's a statistical treatment we can do on the full distribution of the grain that will have with a statistical calculation will help to find the most probable burial dose of the sample. So for modern deposits, this bootstrap MAM paleo dose should be close to zero. And then we have the grain in between that can be explained by several processes. For example, a grain that could be partially bleached or with inherited dose, which means that it have been deposited and buried in past deposits, and it still have this dose in its crystal. So with this typology, we come to this slide. For each sample, we obtain a distribution of the luminescent signal. And what I've tried to do during the project I will present, or in general in all my PhD, is try to explain the variation in the distribution of the luminescent signal in terms of morphological dynamics, and try to use the variation I see in the distribution to quantify surface processes. So in the first part of my PhD, I focused on the Rangitiki River, which is located in the North Island of New Zealand. And I've used luminescence as a new tool for tracing surface processes and sediment sources. So in this part of my PhD, I've used luminescence, I would say, in a classical way to date T-rays, but in a context of very high erosion rate, where dating was a bit challenging because of the poor bleaching in the river. And in the case of the Rangitiki, we document time variation in incision rates, in particular driven by nick point retreat. And then I've also studied the full distribution of my samples in complement to this dating approach. And this was the first time I could see that we could trace the origin of the particle from luminescence in single grain. In the case of the Rangitiki, we demonstrate an important contribution of landslides via the study of the percentage of saturated grain. So these both aspects were published in a paper earlier this year in the journal Earth Surface Processes and Landform. And today, I will present you another part of my PhD, which on which I focused this time on using luminescence as a tool to quantify sediment transport and storage in floodplain. This time, I consider river from the South Island of New Zealand. So I measure luminescent signal in single grain in two braided rivers from the South Island, the Rakaia and the Waimakariri. Most of the sample come from the Canterbury Plain, the CP here and there, where we consider no lateral input from river flanks and no connection with tributaries. So here you see a typical aspect of these braided rivers. Here we are on the Canterbury Plain, so you see that the rivers, these rivers are very wide, and they transfer a huge amount of sediment from the Southern Alps, among the highest sediment yield in the world. So we measured luminescent signal in modern deposits. So here you can see we are here. It's a picture we took with the drone. And we collect sand from modern deposits. The aim of this project was to look for variation along stream. So here we sample several river deposits along stream braided river, and we look for variation in the distribution of the luminescent signal. And our hypothesis was this variation varies due to transport and storage. And the next idea was that we could use this variation to provide quantitative insight into sediment transfer in river systems. So we measured the luminescent signal in the river, and we estimated three metrics. First, the percentage of bleached grain. So here you see that the percentage of brains that were well bleached in our sample is quite high at the upstream part of the river, and quite low, sorry, at the upstream part of the river, and it increased towards downstream to reach up to 70% of well-bleached brain downstream. Then we look at a second metric, the percentage of saturated brain. So here you see that we see a decrease in the percentage of saturated brain towards downstream. Next, we also look at the mean luminescent signal, and you see here that it decreased towards downstream in both rivers. So we estimated characteristic length scale by fitting exponential curve on those data. We obtained characteristic length scale of BL here of about 100 kilometers for the percentage of bleached brain, LSAT of about 25 kilometers for the percentage of saturated brain, and L mean of 72 kilometers for the mean luminescent signal. Then we thought, how can we get quantitative information on transport and storage from this data? And to investigate this, we develop a numerical model that simulates the growth and decay of the luminescent signal during the transfer of particles along a river stream. So I develop a code that is this model, and it considers an input of stock of grain, and then each grain alternate step of transport and deposition and storage and so on until the grain reach river mouth. The dynamic of transport of the grain in the river is determined by several parameters. The first parameter is the transport length, which corresponds to the distance of transport during a single flood event. We define this value randomly using a non-exponential distribution. And in all the simulation we tried, we vary the mean between 0.2 and 20 kilometers. The second parameter is the probability of the grain to be exposed to sunlight. If a grain is exposed to sunlight, its luminescent signal is reset. So we test this parameter in the range between 0.01 to 0.5 chance to be exposed to sunlight. And then third parameter is the resting time of the grain between two displacements, which we define randomly using a Pareto distribution with a long tail. And we vary the mean of this distribution here between 1 and 800 years. So when the grain is stored and buried in a deposit here, it can regenerate. And we define the rate of regeneration at 3 gray per thousand years, which seems to be the typical dose rate of the sediment in the Canterbury Plain. So here, it's an example for one grain. We follow the evolution of the luminescent signal of the grain along stream the river, and we record the 3 parameters. In particular, we see that here we have the transport length here on the y-axis. Here we choose a simulation of a transport length 2 kilometers. And you see that sometimes the dose, so the luminescence of the grain, go back to zero. It's because sometimes the grain is exposed to sunlight. Then we have the third parameter, which is the resting time of the grain. Here, it's an average of 200 years, but you see that the maximum for this simulation in particular reached 4,000 years. So each time the grain is buried, it regenerates. And then here you have the distance that the grain go from upstream to downstream. Here is another simulation. This time we have a resting time of 2 years, a transport length of 1 kilometer and a probability to be breached of 0.05. So you see that this time the maximum of resting time is 100 years. So it's much slower. And the grain is only bleached once here. Or maybe several times, but it's this only one time that it has an effect. So we ran a thousand of simulations like those. And for one simulation, we track the path of 400 grains to correspond to our data. And each grain has its own pathways on the river. And regularly on the river, we measure the three metrics, which are the percentage of bleached grain, the mean luminescent signal, and the percentage of bleached grain. So here it's a short animation. You see that all the grains have their own pathways. They all reach downstream. And what we do is that regularly, we look at our three metrics. What we obtain is this type of graph. We have here one simulation with a resting time of 1 year, a transport length of 2 kilometers, and a probability to be bleached of 0.05. So you see that qualitatively, the data are similar to the data from natural system, because what we see is that the saturation and the mean luminescent signal decrease towards downstream, and the percentage of bleached grain increase towards downstream. For each curve, we calculate the characteristic landscape. So what happened here is that we use a full bleaching model, which means that when the grain is exposed to sunlight, its signal is completely reset. And using this model, we were not able to approach the characteristic land scale from natural system. Here you see that on X and Y axis, 2 by 2 is the characteristic land scale from the three metrics. The red line are the characteristic land scale from natural system. And each blue point is one simulation. So one simulation is a combination of the three parameters: resting time, probability to be exposed to sunlight, and transport length. And what we want is that this blue point here, this characteristic land scale from the simulation, reproduce the characteristic land scale from natural system. So we would like to have blue points close to where the red line are crossing here, but we couldn't do that. So we thought that we could add, we could consider another thing in our model to best reproduce the data from the natural system. And what we found is that we could introduce partial bleaching, which is when a grain is exposed to sunlight and that not all the electrons move back to stable state. This, the signal is only partially reset. So we introduce this effect into the model and we run again a thousand of simulations with this partial bleaching model. So here we have a simulation with a resting time of 100 years, transport length of 1 kilometer and a probability to be bleached of 0.05. And you see that the percentage of saturated grain decreased towards downstream, the mean luminescent signal also, and the percentage of bleached grain increased. So we found the same thing, but with this model, we could better reproduce the data. First, we can examine the effect of changing the input parameter. So for example, if we change the transport length, what is the effect on the characteristic landscape? So if we focus on this graph here, the top graph, we have a resting time of 200 years and a probability to be bleached of 0.02. And what we see is that for short transport length, for example, 200 meters, the characteristic land scale, the percentage of saturated grain decreases faster. So the characteristic land scale is smaller. And for long transport length here, you see that the decrease is much longer. Then we can examine the effect of changing the probability of the grain to be exposed to sunlight. So for example, here we have the probability of 0.02, here a probability of 0.2. And this time, if we focus only on one color on this graph, we have the mean transport length of 200 meters here. And you see here that the percentage of saturated grain decreases much faster when the probability to be bleached is higher. We can examine the third parameter. If we change the resting time this time, so we have the same probability to be bleached, and we can focus only again on one color. And you see that changing the resting time with this average resting time doesn't affect the decrease in the percentage of saturated grain. On the contrary, here we look at the evolution of the percentage of bleached grain along the river, and you see that for resting time of 2 years, it increased towards downstream, and it's not increasing for resting time of 200 years. So in fact, the reason for that is that when we have long resting time, the signal of the grain in storage regenerates due to irradiation, and it regenerates sufficiently for this grain to never be considered as well bleached. We can also examine the effect of changing the parameter on the third metric, the mean luminescent signal here in green. And what we obtain is those graphs here. It's for the partial bleaching model this time. So again, the red line are the characteristic land scale from natural system. And we have the green dot circle here that are the simulation from the model, so a combination of parameters. And this time, you see that we use a key to test, and we obtain 15 best fit that reproduce the data from natural system. So of course, for now, it's a non-unique solution, but it's already interesting. We thought about the solutions that were the most physically realistic and in the context of the Rakaia and the Wemakariri. And we come to the conclusion that the average transport length in those rivers varied between 2 and 10 kilometers, and that the average resting time of the particles varied between 20 and 150 years. This allows to calculate the transit time of the grain in the food chain from here to the ocean. And we estimate that the most probable average transit time of the particle vary from 2 to 10,000 years. The virtual velocity, which is the average time speed of the grain in the river, we could calculate also varied between 20 to 95 meters per year. So here we coupled luminescence from modern sediment and a very simple numerical model. And we see that it can provide innovative data with regard to sediment transport and storage. This study also highlights that we need to better understand the partial bleaching of the grain, which is a necessary condition in our model to reproduce the data. So I almost come to the conclusion now of this talk. As a general conclusion, I would like to say that I think luminescence can be very insightful to study surface processes, in particular when we measure it at the single grain scale. So here, measuring the luminescent signal of modern sediment in single grain, we see that it could provide quantitative information on transport and storage, as suggested in the literature. We provide a comprehensive data set of along stream modern sediment with similar trends for two braided rivers in New Zealand. And thanks to the development of a numerical model that reproduces the evolution of the luminescent signal in modern sediment, we could estimate transport length and storage time of the particle in the river. So I think this opened a lot of new possibility for future works. We could study other rivers and coupling it with other methods, for example, the concentration in beryllium 10 meteoric, for example, in the study from Repatch et al. In 2020. We could also study how parameters such as virtual velocity and transit time that we measured at the end of the model vary according to fluvial style, climate, or tectonic. We could also try to gather more data from luminescence. For example, if you use the multiple elevated temperature IRSL protocol that you can find in Rhodes et al. In 2022, or if you use quartz sensitivity or electron spin resonance, which are similar techniques but that have bleaching properties quite different from feldspar. This could provide much more information. Also, we should study in more detail partial bleaching. This will be investigated in a French-German research project, Wearing Down, from 2022 to 2025. And I thank you for your attention. I hope you enjoy this talk and feel free to ask me any questions.
Thanks a lot for this very interesting talk, Anne. So the chat is now open for questions. You can also raise your hand and ask for being unmuted if you want to ask your question directly. We already have a couple of questions in the chat, so we'll start reading the first one. This is from Jingtang Kim. Hi, Anne. Thanks for a very inspiring talk. Your three indices all show monotonic change with the downstream distance. What if there are spikes on such trending lines? Could your model deal with these non-monotonic scenarios?
Yeah, it's a very interesting question. I think spikes, it's like a big variation, or I'm not sure I understand what is spikes.
Do you want to clarify?
I think for now, with on purpose, we've choose two rivers that were very straightforward. We do not consider for now input from river flanks or any connection with tributaries to make it simple at a first try. But I think in the near future, when we will know that we have more knowledge on how it worked for a simple river, of course we could try to analyze other river. For example, if there is a landslide, maybe we could see it in the trend, of course, and it will not be monotonic. Yeah, but I think it's more for future, but I think it's doable.
Okay, then we have another question from Christina. Thanks for the great talk, Anna. We know that low temperature post IRR signals can be susceptible to anomalous fading. Did you measure fading rates and or attempt to take this into consideration in your modeling?
So what I've done is that at first we've tried several temperature of post IRR. And we found the one that was less susceptible to anomalous fading. And we also measured fading in some of our sample, and it was very little. But so we are not considering any fading in our sample right now. But I think it's important to keep in mind that fading affects feldspar and we should pay attention to that. But for in our case, it was okay. But yeah, in some other setting, maybe it's more important.
I do have a very naive question, actually. Yes, I've never really worked with OSL data. How fast does it take for one single grain to be bleached? And in other words, if the question is more, what will control the probability of bleaching on a river? Is it size, the climate, a bit of both?
I think the braided system is a context where bleaching is relatively possible because there is a lot of space where the grain can be spread, and I think we have 20% of saturated grain, but it's little compared to, for example, I measure the other river, the Rangitiki River, which is a meandering river with high bedrock walls. And in this river, we had much more saturated grain, even now, like 50% or more. So I think, yes, the shape, the river morphology is playing a major role. And that's why we focus also on this braided river to have this simplest context. But also I think that, of course, the climate, I mean, the sediment flux and so on is also affecting the river, the bleaching, probability of bleaching, yes. In fact, we also see a relation between erosion and luminescence. It's another study I've also conducted. And in context of high erosion rate, we see a higher number of saturated grain. So we don't know yet if it's related to landslide or to the sediment flux, but we see in context of high erosion, we have more saturated grain. Yeah.
Okay, so now we have one more question, and it is from Luca via Kim Huppert. They want to thank you for the interesting talk. And they also ask, would it be possible to extend the method, different grain sizes, and explore their different transport velocities using surface luminescence signal or larger clasts?
I think the thing is that this single grain disc I show you are made for a specific grain size, but I know there are some for other grain size, so we could try that, but it's still relatively the same grain size, same big class of grain size. But I think what we could do is, once you have the data for single grain, if we measure, for example, the very fine and very thicker mean luminescent signal of a long stream, and we compare it to the single grain data, then we can see the difference if the decrease in the mean luminescent signal is different, and then try to have a qualitative, at least a value of a transport length, I think.
Okay, do we have any other question? Something else that you would like to ask to Anna?
I can see one. The distance between sampling sites.
Ah, okay. Sorry.
No, I can read it.
Right. So Jintan is asking again, what is the rough distance between your sample sites? Could you please give some recommendations for the sampling strategy for this kind of exploration?
I think here we sampled every 20 kilometers or something like that. I don't know if there is a best. I think too close, it's useless because you don't see any evolution, but maybe 10 or 20 kilometers is nice. It depends a lot on the river length and also on the possibility on the field, because sometimes, in fact, if you see the map here, we didn't collect any data more upstream here or in some section here because it's very hard to access the river actually. So it's also dependent on that, I guess.
We still have time for a couple of questions if you have a last one. Otherwise, thanks a lot for this very interesting talk. It has been recorded and will be uploaded on YouTube in a bit. I will just remind a last time that we are looking for speaker suggestions, so feel free to drop us an email. Right, if in 10 seconds there are no more questions or raised hand, I will assume that there's no more question. And I think we can thank you again, Anne, for this very great talk. And I'm sure we're all looking forward to seeing the follow-up on that story that you will work on with that German project. So thanks again. And
thank you.
See you all in September or October, depending on when we will start again.